Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Once again, I need to reorganize my video schedule. As you might have gathered already, both the lives of my mother as well as my own are rather harsh, and there's barely any notable stretch of time without at least some kind of disaster. During the last couple of weeks, my mother developed some serious lower chest pains combined with bleeding and partial loss of bladder function. And as it turned out, there was a huge tumor that needed to be removed as soon as possible. Initially, the doctors only wanted to remove the tumor itself during a keyhole surgery, but while they were at it, they also took out the ovaries because they didn't seem to be that healthy either. Samples of each were sent to the lab for testing. Preliminary results are already in, and for now everything looks to be alright in a way that no further surgeries will be needed. But some of the results take a couple of weeks to materialize, so we are in for an uncomfortable period of waiting. We really do hope that this is it, since further surgeries won't be minimally invasive anymore and will require several weeks of hospitalization, not just one. She already needed to undergo two separate surgeries in the general area of this more recent problem. Both times it was malign cancer. The first one left her with some heavy bleeding as she got out of the hospital. And with the second one, she suffered from a thrombosis, which in turn led to a lung embolism. The latter nearly got her killed. Her mother died to cancer at a pretty young age, when my mom was still a teenager, so we got a family history of cancer. This also serves to demonstrate once again that there's a constant stream of bad events, disease and pain in store for us. And my own condition isn't that great either, but unfortunately, I'm already back at a stage where I can at least keep up a basic lifestyle by myself. Now, due to the sudden turn of events, everything we are working on will be delayed for 2 or 3 weeks in the most fortunate case. Even these couple of weeks are difficult to sustain, since I urgently need my radiation therapy. The guy at the radiology department told me something about that I got 6 months left before it will be too late to act, but the doctors of the actual sarcoma surgery department made it clear that I got way less time than this, and that's exactly what I think too. Not that what they think would have any impact on what they do. They are the ones who are constantly delaying the handover of my medical documents and image data. Without this data, I can't approach another hospital, not in Japan or the Netherlands, not even in Germany. I want to get a second opinion, the cost estimate with which I want to approach my healthcare providers. Maybe they will cover for at least some portion of the costs. But all these plans are meaningless without these darn documents. I can't afford to pay for another CT and MRI work up abroad, and as more time gets wasted between the most recent images and the start of the treatment, the more likely that new data will be required to avoid messing up stuff due to outdated images. After I finally receive something worth presenting, I still need to get everything translated, since some handmade translation on my own behalf won't be sufficient for the hospitals in question. Even if everything goes according to plan, with my mother getting back on track quickly, it will get very close, too close for comfort, to be honest. But I still can't afford to undergo the radiation treatment here in Germany. The information I received on side effects just recently is more unfavorable than I initially thought. The papers that I need to sign more or less free the hospital of any responsibility in the case something happens. It's clearly stated that severe and lasting side effects might occur, and that the chance for it is about 4 times higher than with regular patients. Well, if cancer patients can ever be called regular, that is. I don't know why exactly that is the case, but that's what's written there. As you might recall from my The System Strikes Back video, this was a high level of risks. It's exactly the opposite of what I require. There's even a note that I should refrain from any kind of traveling, because the radiation therapy will affect my immune system. I'm well aware that the doctors at the hospital don't care at all about my plans of leaving Germany for good. And for them it's not an issue at all if I'm forced to stay here forever. More money for them, I guess. But this also means that they are okay with each and every side effect that will destroy the last thing that makes life worth living for me in the first place. They should actually read their own papers every now and then, since there's a section in there where they say that the psychological situation of each and every patient is very important in regard to the overall success of the treatment. But in their mind, it's just my job, getting my head straight, submitting myself to their rule, It's always a one-way street here in Germany. I mean, did you ever think about that they too could help in improving my acceptance of this necessary treatment, or, well, God forbid, help me find my way to Japan or at least the Netherlands? Of course, they wouldn't think about this. Germany allegedly possesses the best healthcare system in the world, and no one would ever want to get out of here, and that's the end of the discussion. Another thing that I have to keep in mind is that there is a new possible treatment option for my cancer emerging. Clinical trials are taking place for a new approach to my special subtype of sarcoma. An antibody has been developed by a medical company based in Kawasaki in Japan that clings to certain cells that are more or less exclusively used by my cancer to grow and survive while being non-existent or extremely rare in regular organs. These antibodies are radioactive and able to destroy most of the cells that my cancer feasts on. Synovial sarcomas are very much resistant to both chemo and radiotherapy, so instead their supply network is getting attacked. This doesn't just work on the big primary tumor, but also in distant metastatic disease, or to clear the area surrounding the resection site from tumor cells that got left behind after surgery. This, by the way, is the situation that I find myself in at the moment. With animals, the cancer could be killed and stopped for quite a while with just one injection, but it did come back after a while, which is typical for synovial sarcomas. The good thing is that this new treatment can be applied several times and not just one single time like the conventional radiotherapy that is planned for me. My sarcoma is based on a genetic disposition, so without permanent alteration of my DNA, a therapy approach that doesn't have severe side effects and that can be applied repeatedly looks like a real breakthrough and the closest thing to a proper treatment yet. But with humans, simple injections won't be sufficient to be on the safe side for the most part. Low-dose radiation therapy is deployed to amplify the effect of the antibodies. With these radioimmune agents injected into the bloodstream, radiotherapy will have a much improved effect on the cancer and less side effects than everything else due to the lower dose required. With this so-called radioimmunotherapy, there won't be the need for the carpet bombing approach that is in store for me in Germany right now. Despite this, you can only receive a certain amount of radiation to any given area of the body without getting poisoned by it. By completing a full course of conventional radiotherapy with like 70 gray, I might lock myself out of this new and more effective approach because I already reached my personal limit of radiation. I asked my doctors in Germany about this new treatment, but they are not taking part in these trials themselves and are also unwilling to help me get into one of those at some other place. They treat the whole affair as if I would be talking about voodoo medicine and not taking it serious at all. But aside from this Japanese company, there are similar trials being carried out all over the USA at leading cancer hospitals. With in my personal case, high risks of the conventional radiotherapy in mind that I will present to you in the next 40 or so minutes, I'm not going to throw this chance away just to please some German doctors whose institutions aren't good enough to get involved in the development of future treatments that promise to be way more effective. As an alternative, there would be less side effects with proton therapy, and they also have this one available at my hospital. But again, this isn't an offer for me, probably due to financial reasons. Healthcare providers in Germany only pay for this more expensive sort of radiation treatment in combination with clinical trials. Since my sarcoma is so rare, there aren't any trials going on for them at the hospital where I get treated at the moment. Maybe there's another reason, but since they don't like to explain things, everything remains mysterious. The reason why I still have to work out the quirks of conventional radiotherapy is that because I don't have any professional assistance, guidance, or just documents available, this new approach might not be suited for my personal case after all, with me being unable to find that out on my own behalf, and I think it's better to be prepared. Video number 4 of my Last Stop Japan playlist was more or less exclusively about this topic of radiation treatment and also the German healthcare system in general, but I had no documentation that I could have presented to you back then, while the documents that I received in the meantime won't be of much use to get a recommendation regarding this new radioimmunotherapy, a second opinion or cost estimate about, I can at least go through them with you, so let's get into it. As you can see, all of it is in German, so I will translate the important sections on the go and with some markups. On the left, we got the area marked that needs to get irradiated. It's actually quite big and looks more like a boat side than precision. On the right side, it states what parts of my body are actually affected by the cancer. It's the muscles and supporting tissue of my right arm as well as the shoulder girdle. Directly in the aftermath of the surgery, they talked about the clavicular bone and that there were a couple of dents in there from the cancer. They wanted to do some tests on how much of the cancer got left behind there, but they never got back to me. I guess they don't care that much, because radiation treatment should be able to take care of this, if only they would stop to delay it any further. On the second page, we are getting into the possible side effects. As a rule of thumb, previous dispositions like surgeries and whatnot increase the overall risk. Before looking at the details regarding the checked paragraphs, I want to direct your attention to a statement that gets repeated a number of times throughout these pages, and it's the assumption that a lot of delayed side effects have absolutely nothing to do with the radiation treatment and are solely caused by the previous damage inflicted by the tumor itself. This leaves me with the impression that whatever may happen, the hospital staff and their treatment are not responsible for it. These things should be investigated carefully, but instead they decline all possibly cause and effect chains right from the get-go. Since various doctors made numerous mistakes concerning the treatment of my mother before and after her brain hemorrhage, I tried to take it to court, but here in Germany it's next to impossible to win. It's not a fair game at all. Only about 5 to 10% of all cases get decided in favor of patients. Do you think that this many patients, a lot of whom can't fight or even speak for themselves anymore, requiring relatives to step up, so that all these people are that bored with their life and harbor so much ill will and negative energy that they go to court for years on end based on lies and false accusations? Well, there will be some of those cases, but surely not enough of them to comprise 90%. Now, right here, with these papers that I need to sign prior to any therapy, I sort of acknowledge that there's a lot of damage from the tumor already and that the hospital bears no responsibility for the stuff that happens next. I can't think of a way how I could actually come up with solid proof that they did something wrong during radiation or that they misjudged the risks. And with my mother's cases, I had a way better starting position, but still no chance to win. With issues that concern ICU treatment of new surgical and radiological problems that are difficult and rare to begin with, they ask a regular doctor with no practical knowledge of these issues that's sitting behind some desk at an office to submit an assessment. That doctor who was working full-time just writing assessments all day just produced some nonsense that makes no sense whatsoever, and not debunking my accusations at all in the process. But that seems to be enough for the medical staff in question to get acquitted on behalf of the healthcare providers. No further questions asked, and no way for me to challenge this assessment. But even if there would be a chance with these court proceedings, how long will it take to go up the escalating ladder of courts? With the expected lifetime that I've left, I won't be able to see it through anyway. And every one of them knows this. Let's get back to the checked paragraphs. All these papers were actually filled out by the deputy head of the radiotherapy department. It's not my own writing or that of my mother. Therefore, I removed her signature. He's not really a bad guy, to be honest. Most issues lie with the people from the actual surgery team, as they are the ones that are in charge of my case overall. The people at the center for radiotherapy just do what they're told, and at least that's what they claim for themselves. I wasn't present with that appointment, by the way, up to this point. I did everything that was asked of me, but I'm running out of patience with the harsh and unfriendly attitude. Therefore, I decided to not show up anymore, to make it clear that they indeed have crossed the line and that I'm not making any jokes about this. Well, I'm an autist, and if they're unable to offer any kind of concession, then I will go down due to this, hoping that my mother will be able to kick some butts in return. You see, I don't have much left in life, and I can't afford to give up my dignity and beliefs if they don't start to actually treat me like a human being and not some piece of meat or a damaged electronic device. They can simply fuck off. They still think that I'm one of the regular German guys who will cave in once there's enough pressure put onto him. Well, that's a mistake. They should be ashamed on how they, as medical doctors, treat terminal ill people. But I didn't really expect anything else from Germany. There was a reason why I never wanted to get any kind of cancer treatment here. Things at the hospital in question started out shitty back at the start of September, earlier this year, and they remained that way. But enough of this for now. Among the immediate side effects can be skin and muscle inflammations of the irradiated area. And since this area is also very close to my right ear and the neck, incidents there are to be expected, I guess, including mucosa issues. Now, inflammations can lead to tearing skin and open wounds, as the wound healing process gets messed up by the radiation therapy. These wounds and tears, should they materialize, will require special bandages and additional treatment by medical staff. Muscle inflammations can lead to permanent damage with partial or complete loss of function. Unfortunately, my lungs are at least partially exposed to radiation. But here they talk about coughing as the only side effect, but we are getting to some more severe stuff a bit later. Hypothyroidism is checked, which is a bit strange, since the center of my throat is not really close to the radiation field. I already suffer from Hashimoto's disease, and most of my thyroid has already vanished. Cause unknown, by the way, doctors blame autoimmune disorder. The inevitable hair loss won't be a problem for me, as I've lost all my body hair when I was about 15. There has been no change to this in the last decades, and again, doctors have no clue and can only think of autoimmune disorder. And next up is thrombosis and embolisms. Well, this one can get pretty dangerous, and most of the time you won't get much warning before things start to get ugly. My mom already suffered from lung embolism in the aftermath of a surgery at the end of the 90s. The doctors were clueless, again, and afterwards they blamed protein S deficiency, which in turn leads to an increased risk of thrombosis. Most of these disorders are congenital, and therefore I could suffer from it too. As a lot of stuff gets damaged during radiation, this might also carry over into the immediate span of time once the treatment has been completed. I did plan to leave for Japan ASAP after this, so with the very long distance flight ahead of me, I might run into some trouble. Now, that's apparently it for the immediate side effects, and we are talking delayed effects now, which are way more numerous and also more problematic for me to deal with. It can take up to several months for some of them to show up. And by this time I would be in Japan already, probably without healthcare coverage. Since no hospital in Japan treated me in the first place, should everything work out along the wishes of the German doctors, they would think of me as stupid, leaving my country and healthcare system behind on such short notice. And in a situation like this, no one in Japan will feel responsible for this situation, and I'm pretty sure that my German hospital and the doctors there have no interest or intent on helping me to pay the medical bills in Japan while I try to fix the side effects of the treatment. They will outright decline any causality on the foundation of the time span between treatment and onset of symptoms alone. I have no reason to believe that there would be a more positive reaction on their part this time around. I guess they will more or less disallow any kind of traveling for months after the treatment to be on the safe side. Then it will be my own fault altogether if I don't heed their warnings. There might be at least a slight chance that some Japanese doctors will feel responsible for the side effects of their own treatment, so might be eligible for reduced bills at least. Skin pigmentation changes do occur quite often, but considering the huge amount of scars I have due to the surgery, I don't think that this will be a major issue. I'm looking pretty freaky in that area already. I lost some muscles and fat tissue, and the symmetry has been lost somewhat. Way better than to lose an arm or maybe even the shoulder, I guess, though. Swelling and fibrosis might be more of a problem, and I still have swellings from the surgery itself, since the liquids of the lymphatic system require some time to find new ways to disperse. Fibrosis means that any kind of tissue will become very hard and inflexible. The effects can vary greatly depending on the tissue that gets affected and the severity of the fibrosis itself. This also affects muscles, by the way, and as you can guess, if these suffer from fibrosis, the function will be affected. Fibrosis can't be cured or dissolved, only prevented with some experimental medication that blocks certain processes within one's body. I guess there are severe side effects to them, as they are not mandatory while undergoing radiotherapy. I couldn't find any additional information on the internet, but here in these papers they talk about that fibrosis is more of a problem in the general area of pre-existing scars, As a result of the surgery, I have a lot of scars and they are far away from being fully healed. That alone will require way more time than I have available right now. I don't really know what to expect from a growth or shrinkage of tissue surrounding scars. Now, spider veins are not really nice to look at and can't be cured either. Combined with some other side effects, the area that gets irradiated might end up looking really ugly, I guess. And since the area marked for radiation is actually quite large, it won't be just some minor cosmetic issue. Next up is complete or partial loss of thyroid function. Since I got the Hashimoto's disease already, with only a small part of my thyroid still working, I should be taking supplementary hormones anyway. But losing the little bit of function that's still left is bad news nonetheless. And on the next page we are getting into some more interesting stuff. Lymphatic edema is something that the doctors in the Netherlands thought of as very likely to happen. Due to the radiation treatment, two things will actually occur. First thing is all lymphatic nodes in the area of the radiation treatment will get destroyed. And in addition, some of the channels where the fluid is regularly traveling along will lose functionality through scarring and whatnot. There are several different stages of lymphatic edema. A lifelong requirement for manual lymphatic drainage looks like a sure thing at the moment for me. I have more trust in what the doctors in the Netherlands said today. These edemas, which optically present as mild to huge swellings, might also cause circulatory problems of my right arm and shoulder, as well as limited flexibility and strength, as well as pain and stuff like this. I guess no one can tell right now, but it would be very important for me to know how often I would require the manual drainage. I don't really have the money to be reliant on medical assistance in Japan on a regular, lifelong level. Also, how on earth should I be able to travel along the countryside of Japan for days with constant need for medical attention? I don't know if I will be able to find places where I can receive my treatment in every village or city along the way. The people there won't be speaking English, and in some places the required infrastructure just won't be there. My mother didn't have any underlying issue with lymphatic nodes, but due to the low amount of movement, she required two drainages a week. This issue resolved itself after she recovered somewhat and went out more often, but this isn't applicable for me. In some cases, edema might require surgery, and this can escalate quickly, including even to amputations. Surgery and radiation in this area combined are nothing to joke about in the end. And amplification of pre-existing circularity problems won't be helpful at all regarding this topic. Now, the next paragraph is like everything thrown in together. Maybe they forgot to mention that I might be more susceptible to get hit by meteors or struck by lightning. So it's about localized necrosis of soft tissue, cartilages and bones, easily fractured bones, partial movement limitations or complete stiffening of joints. We might have hit one of the key sections here, since they made the effort of stating that the majority of these side effects, should they occur, are a direct consequence of the tumor and not the radiation therapy. Well, I don't think that I need to elaborate on the actual things at hand. These are surely pretty severe things to happen without any way of countering them for the most part. Should I get hit by one or even several of those, I can throw all my plans regarding a life in Japan away. And also funny is the fact that while trying to prevent losing my arm or shoulder to cancer, I might destroy the functionality of them myself through radiation treatment. Now, this is a very uncomfortable spot to be in. It would be way easier to come to a conclusion if the doctors would provide me with reliable percentage estimates, but it looks like they don't care that much. Nerves getting damaged or paralyzed will have equal results, no way of getting these fixed either. Apparently, we are still in the age of medicine men. Why can't they just reproduce and replace nerves already? I do think that they are carrying their heads a little bit too high, with the basic level of, let's call it, treatment that's an offer here. A little bit like bloodletting in the Middle Ages, like a hostage situation where someone holds another person at knife point, and now you go in and shoot him with a shotgun, a 12-gauge buckshot loaded. The hostage will have a certain chance to survive the collateral damage. I mean, who wants to do the calculations? The German Association for Nuclear Medicine likes to advertise for themselves with the slogan, beams that heal. Well, I don't think that is the right wording here. First and foremost, there's a lot of destruction going on, and coincidentally, a lot of cancer cells are getting destroyed too. Overall, it's more like a club, not like a precision instrument. The rest is just glorified mumbo jumbo, at least in my opinion. And on top, we have some wound healing disorders, especially in combination with future surgeries or lesions in the general irradiation area. It might be possible that another surgery will be required. Maybe some doctors outside of Germany see at least some chances to leave my arm and shoulder in place, in the place where they belong. But other than that, the skin of irradiated areas will stay in a somewhat damaged state and will require special care and precaution for the rest of my life. I already talked about this in my car video a while ago. I already received skin grafts that aren't as resistant to stress as the original skin on the shoulder area. For some cases, you need to do special exercises and physical therapy regularly for years on end. This includes special applications of powders, lotions, and whatnot to prevent the skin from tearing and bleeding. I don't think that I will ever be able to carry backpacks again after I went through with the treatment. Regular cancer patients are like 60 years and up. I guess backpacks and stuff like this is not that much of an issue for them anymore. In addition, they got families and a driver's license more often than not. Things that I do lack. Now, for the skin alone, it is way more likely to suffer from side effects if you have a bright, thin and soft skin. And all this exactly describes the very nature of my skin. A while back, I promised that we will get back to the lungs, and well, here we are. Fibrosis of the lungs might develop. This is some kind of scarring of lung tissue that happens months, sometimes even years after the radiation treatment. Or more precisely, it will get symptomatic at that point, as the scarring is a slow process that mostly goes unnoticed. They only note difficult breathing and coughing right here. But one might end up with a life-threatening situation that requires lung surgery, even including transplantations. Now, we all know that I will never be eligible for such a procedure with my cancer. Not that I would want to go for it anyway. There's always a risk for secondary cancer or leukemia with radiation treatment. But from what I've gathered, the time span at which you can expect these things to appear are way beyond the scope of what's still in store for me. I will never make it through another 20 or even 30 years except for some magic new treatment that pops up out of the blue. So I'm not worrying about this one too much. For now, we are done with the side effects, and they offer a very quick glance on the actual chances of successful treatment here. Again, they don't want to be held responsible for anything, so they admit that despite all efforts, local recurrence of the tumor or metastatic disease can happen anytime. The sheet doesn't say anything about it, but I can tell you that metastatic disease and overall survival with my sort of cancer are not getting influenced by radiotherapy at all. Radiotherapy is only useful in establishing local control to prevent the tumor from coming back in the same area or trying to destroy it as long as it's still very small. The keywords for this are cyberknife or gamma knife and the like. While not applicable for most patients, it might have an effect on overall survival in my personal case, as the surgery options are rather limited, especially due to my own will, as I won't be trying to survive in this shitty world with just my left arm. Local recurrence might happen next to blood vessels, and since I was already bleeding out from the last tumor, this time I'm probably going to bleed internally, and if I decline amputation, I will surely die of this. Now, these papers are meant to build up trust through information. I do think that there's not that much useful information here, as the things are already general and without details. I guess it's the doctor's job to outline all the details on the way, but it would be way better to have this as a written or printed information with percentages of chances added and possible cures or countermeasures listed as well. I also do think that they actually understate the risks of the treatment, as a lot of stuff is missing and I had to fill in the gaps myself. Still, these sheets do create more fear and hesitance than trust. I don't know about you, but that's the way I think. Maybe not as threatening for someone who's got a family and who has lived a full life for maybe 60 years, but it's very intimidating for someone who wants to start a new life at the other end of the world without any kind of support. I already complained about the next part a bit earlier. My attitude and acceptance towards the planned treatment, as well as my overall psychological situation and confidence, are obviously a key to success and will help in stabilizing my immune system. Well, how about the doctors? Stop treating me like some lifeless item that only exists in their minds because of a malfunction called cancer. No other part of me has ever been taken into consideration by them. It's solely my own job to get my head straight and submit myself to everything they want to do with me, no matter the consequences, while also accepting the fact that should those consequences actually materialize, they are all for me to solve. They bear no responsibility or obligations. I don't have any trust in people that can't even be asked to provide documents on what parts of my body actually got removed during surgery, what my life expectancy is like according to their so-called professional opinion, and people who decline talking with my mother about my condition or offering her any kind of advice on the grounds of some legal mumbo-jumbo that they can't talk about me without my consent. They never saw me without my mom, and she was at the hospital 8 or 10 hours every day for 2 weeks straight while I was an inpatient there. I guess they are just hiding behind some missing mandate. I'm curious on what excuse they will actually use next once the mandate gets presented. She already had one at the wedding, but they disliked the handwritten style of it, or a pile of bullcrap. They got asked by me personally 3 times for documents already. I got pushed off every time. I guess they need some more time to falsify the requested documents since they fucked up somewhere. Maybe some guy forgot my pathology samples on a bench at McDonald's or something. The only thing they never forget is to send bills, and you can trust me, there's a lot of them. So they do know pretty well how to get in contact with us. Well, sorry guys, I guess I got a little carried away there. But the thing is getting pretty personal now. The more time they waste, very precious time that I don't have that much left of. I will try to get back to business again. No use of lotions, soap, perfumes, or deodorant during the course of the radiation therapy. Well, the way they pulled off the surgery stopped my right armpit to sweat anyway. God knows where that is. They don't like to talk about things like that, you already know it. So I'm fine without perfumes or deodorants, but not being able to wash myself for like 7 weeks on end, while having to get naked at a German hospital of all things, laying down on the table there, and without the ability of washing any clothes either. Well, that sounds pretty bad to be honest, but I will come back to this at a later date. No rubbing or pressure on the radiation area. Well, I guess I can manage not to touch the area at all, but that's just possible because I'm living the shitty life that I'm used to for years now. No backpacks and stuff. Also no exposure to heat or cold. Well, I'm lucky that it's winter right now, since this won't be possible during summer to avoid any kind of exposure. Radiation therapy might present the area as a severe sunburn over time, so no use of ice packs actually will hurt quite a bit. As I received a couple of doses in Rotterdam, the skin sounded like some freshly cooked meal, since the area is directly next to my ear. I could hear it sizzling. Maybe it was because of the open and aquatic wound, I don't know, but it sounded pretty crazy though. No smokes or alcohol. Well, I managed to stay away from those up to now, so this won't be affecting me at all. Radiation therapy is going to weaken my immune system. Additional precautions to prevent infectious diseases will be required. Now, this sounds ominous when uttered by a German hospital. In addition, I should refrain from traveling abroad. For how long? You can't really travel that far while it's still required to be at the hospital every day for radiation sessions. And did they forget that I wanted to move to Japan at once on the conclusion of the therapy? I guess the Dutch don't care. With this, they are free from any responsibility at least, so I guess they're in the clear. And yeah, I will be getting some rest while doing the therapy. Not that I could do that much anyway in this shitty apartment in this shitty country. I guess I can manage to stick to my daily routines if the radiation fatigue isn't too much for me to handle. And now I should approach my doctors and the medical staff with everything that I want to know, as it's a burden for me. I mean, what the fuck? Now at this point you finally realize that this is just some general sheet written by someone who is not even closely related to that particular hospital or the people who are working there. Otherwise this paragraph would have never found its way into the final edition of this paper. Patients in Germany need to do as they are told, respect the doctors as almighty authorities that can't be questioned at any rate. And you have to be thankful for the benevolence that is getting expressed by the willingness of the medical staff to offer you any kind of treatment in the first place. And be lucky that you're not somewhere in Africa or whatever. be aware of the fact that you are now a rich guy from Russia, awesome oil shake, know your place, and don't be a burden to the healthcare system, be cheap to treat and handle, and never ever look up your condition on the internet. On the internet they got it completely wrong, and everything that's stated online has no relevance whatsoever for the special dimension of time and space that is called Germany, where doctors actually shape the reality. Now it's full up time. This isn't connected to any kind of therapy, be it radio or chemotherapy. Once you suffered from a soft tissue sarcoma with similar denominators like mine, it's considered mandatory to take part in regular checkups, mostly MRI of the originally affected area, and then some CT screenings on top to check for metastatic disease. While these metastatic diseases can pop up in several places, with my type of cancer, the lung is predominantly affected, followed by the lymphatic system, the liver and the brain, but they are way behind in likeliness of occurrence. As I had my last discussion on site with one of the leading surgeons, we talked about Japan, and he just said that after the radiation therapy, I can go on my Japan vacation and then I will be right back in time for my first follow-up here in Germany. Now, I did send him a long letter a couple of weeks earlier, as it was primarily intended for hospital in Japan, and this topic came up a few times prior and also during my stay as an inpatient, but he still thinks that I'm going for a quick vacation though. There won't be any follow-ups for me, at least not in Germany and especially not at that hospital. Not that there would be a lot of options once things start to go away anyway. I won't do any lung surgeries and no chemotherapy. And since at least here in Germany there's no new treatment on the horizon, I guess at that point in time the case is ready to get closed for good. So I better start to go look for alternatives for countries that are actively researching new ways of treatment instead of just waiting for others to do all the work first before adopting it once there are no risks anymore. Mind you, we are talking about risks for investors, doctors and institutions. The patient doesn't really play much of a role here. Next up is a medical history sheet. A lot of stuff is missing there. I did not participate myself on that day, but they do have an extensive history and listing of stuff from the time of my hospitalization, and that was some mere weeks ago. But it still looks like there's no information or data exchange between the different sections and wards of the hospital at all. Just look at my electronic patient file, everything's there, or at least it should be there. Now, I've also developed liver cysts in addition to the tons of cysts in both kidneys, which are in turn responsible for my high blood pressure since I was a teenager. In the Netherlands, I were actually quite happy, though, because I initially thought of these objects as it appeared on a chest and abdomen CT as a metastatic disease. But I want to focus on one thing that the doctor thought was worth noting, and that is a washing obsession. This is not the right term, I think it's more of a germ phobia, a bacteria phobia. A couple of pages earlier they called on me to improve my hygiene and to make sure to take extra precautions to avoid any infections due to my weakened immune system during and after the therapy. And now they say I'm crazy. Well, I have to admit I might be a bit off track, alright? But I had no issues with any obsessions until I had to go toe-to-toe with the German healthcare system and gained some insights that a lot of people thankfully never attain due to the lack of exposure. Germany has got some issues with resistant bacteria and nosocomial infections. The latter are infections that you contract in a hospital. These are mostly of the kind that are resistant to at least some groups of antibiotics. In Germany there has been a lot of pressure on the healthcare system for the last 20 and more years, with a lot of hospitals closing their doors and even more that got privatized from former public or church ownership. A huge chunk of them now reside in the hands of companies that are listed at stock exchanges and where money needs to be generated. I already said in one of my first videos that I don't think of it as a good idea to try to make profits with sick people while you still have some freedom in choosing the place where you want to get treated. Even public university hospitals like the ones I was a patient at in Germany apply the same kind of business methods as their private counterparts. The healthcare system only grants a certain amount of money on a per patient basis, so money is always a big issue here. Let's get into the numbers that are prepared first. Please do note that it's more or less impossible to get accurate figures for the things I'm going to talk about. While Germany and its authorities have ignored this resistant bacteria issue for a long time, they finally woke up a couple of years ago. They kickstarted some useful programs and campaigns But a lot of work also went into adjusting the statistics in a way that makes the people in charge look good. It's the same as with unemployment and other things that are getting regularly focused by national as well as international media. The real numbers are way higher for unemployment, as the official numbers suggest. Someone that's in some training on how you conduct a telephone call isn't registered as unemployed anymore. I won't provide data for this as it's very off topic, but how on earth is it possible that with less working hours overall and way more population than in 1990, we have an all-time high of employment at which our politicians can't stop to rave about, that it never looked better in Germany for the working force. In the end, it's worthless employment of which no regular human being can live off, but hey, at least the statistics do look good. And before we focus on actual data on examples for the resistant bacteria called MRSA, let me tell you that no one in Germany knows how many people die to those buggers each year. They are only estimates, because most hospitals try to play down these kind of infections and there are too few official regulations in place. The government estimate is up to 15,000 deaths a year that can be attributed to infections with resistant bacteria. The leading hospital association in Germany estimates are way lower, 2,500 to 4,000. There you will find the people whose aim is to generate a lot of profit with their portfolio, and the costs need to stay low for that to happen. The Association of Hospital Hygienists, on the other hand, presents numbers as high as 30,000 to 35,000. These are the people who are getting blamed if something goes wrong, if there's an outbreak that gets media coverage, if only locally. In contrast to most other wards and sections of a hospital, the hygienists oftentimes look down upon as some low priority issue, while other personnel at this level consist solely of doctors and in Germany also a lot of university professors. Hygienists are oftentimes regular medical personnel with some kind of add-on qualification. You can imagine that these folks wouldn't run into trouble sitting at a table with only superiors, not only qualification, but especially in payment. Germany got a steep hierarchy in these environments, so you won't have much influence. As you can see, there would be the need for a neutral and independent organization as well as strict rules, because with estimates that differ so greatly, there's surely a big problem at hand. And estimates aren't sufficient, facts are required. Now that we do know that total numbers are most likely bogus anyway, let's focus on the relation between the different numbers instead. Overall, MRSA prevalence for the population in North Rhine-Westphalia, that's actually the federal state that I live in, is estimated at 57.6 per million, compared to the Netherlands with just 1.8 per million. The comparison is quite interesting actually, as North Rhine-Westphalia is very similar in size and overall population. I'm really bad at math, but from what I guess, that's just about 3% of the German number. Or in other words, Germany has more than 30 times more people with infections outside of hospitals per 1 million inhabitants, at least in the state where I live in. That already showed to have a huge negative impact on other numbers, like unemployment, for example. And while we are at it, let's have a quick look at two different maps and one additional page to pick up my numbers. As you can see on the second map, with just the different federal states of Germany on it, the state where I live in failed to achieve any kind of substantial improvement over the depicted time frame. Now, for actual inpatients of hospitals, this number is at 2.5% for the whole of Germany, compared to 0.2 for the Netherlands. I don't trust the German figure one bit, but I promise we want to look for relations first and foremost. It's still more than 10 times more likely to contract such an infection on a general or surgical ward in a German hospital than it is in the Netherlands. Next up is the most dangerous spot in a hospital, the intensive care unit. The invasive nature of the treatments there with lung machines, catheters and stuff greatly increases your personal risk, let alone the fact that there's a reason that you are at an ICU in the first place. Something very serious must be going on and you will have wounds and a weakened immune reaction. MRSA prevalence at these special wards is at more than 25% in Germany, but differs greatly, sometimes coming even close to 40%. In the Netherlands, on the other hand, you are facing a risk that is lower than 5%. That's the worst Dutch performance indicator so far. But in Germany, you have to deal with a risk that's at least 5 times greater. As we already discussed, death tolls are hard to come by, and I expect any official German number to be too low and hand-adjusted, but we will stick with these for now. For 2015, it stated that 210 people died to MRSA in Germany, While in the Netherlands, there hasn't been a single death attributed to MSA for the period of the last 10 years combined. Now, I do know that there's a slight difference in overall population for both countries, but there's no way one can use this as an excuse given the huge gap. You are used to get some proof from me, and not just some random mumbling. Digging into these issues once again was surely no fun at all for me, but I like to keep a coherent style of argument throughout all my videos. And the first paper we got here is from a German medical company that actually sells a lot of stuff in regard to our current topic, but there won't be any outward lies as the competition. I would be filing complaints at court quicker than I can read aloud the phrases that are relevant here. Now, I was always thinking about sending the guys at my hospital a link to these videos. I can already imagine how some of those wise guys can't wait to disassemble my argumentation in regard to Japan, especially now that we are talking about bacteria. While it may require inhuman discipline, hold your horses for now, I will get back to you a bit later. For now, I will just read this text for you, because I think that the content in there speaks for itself. Whereas in the USA, Japan and southern European countries, a high prevalence of MSA between 20 and 60% exists, the prevalence in the Netherlands and Scandinavian countries is less than 3%. In Germany, the number of MSA infections has dramatically increased and is a serious problem in the form of nosocomial infections. In the past 10 years, an alarming increase in the prevalence of MSA from 2% to approximately 23% has been observed. Even in various hospitals and between different wards within the same hospital, the prevalence of MSA varies. Along with non-critical antibiotic use, the insufficient implementation of prophylactic hygiene measures, and inadequate staff training are in particular the reasons for the significant increase in MRSA colonization. Insufficient MRSA management thus leads to the continued spread of MRSA in our hospitals. Urgently needed measures in this case are the introduction of standard hygiene and adequate outbreak management, as well as control of antibiotic use. In particular, however, the introduction of MSA screening based on rapid and reliable diagnosis during or even better before inpatient admission of patients is indispensable. Next up, we have a magazine article published by and for the German community of medical doctors where you can get another look at the development of this issue. I've been a frequent guest at hospitals all my life, but as you can see here, there have been times where getting hospitalized wasn't as dangerous as it is today. I do know that the German authorities claim to have made a lot of progress in the last couple of years. Now, the interesting thing is if this progress is just thanks to adjusted statistics, or if there was an actual change for the better in real life. Let's have a look at some data from the European Antimicrobial Surveillance Network. We focus on MSA only, and the most recent data from 2016. First up is a map where you can see that Germany isn't the most dangerous place to be, but surely not one of the safest either. These colors, by the way, don't do the Netherlands justice, in my opinion, since having a number lower than 1% is pretty difficult to achieve for a proper country that actually has millions of inhabitants. And next up, we are taking a closer look on the actual numbers, and you can see that we in Germany are below average in performance. With all the countries where I tried to arrange cancer treatment earlier this year, at the top. The officially reported figures for Germany are actually somewhere around 10% for the time frame right here. This is one way to deal with statistics, I guess. They just count samples that are resistant to two or more groups of antibiotics. If you would stick with just one resistance, the number would be higher than 20%. Since just about 77% of isolates are susceptible to all kinds of approaches, according to the data right here. But as always, with some kind of wacky data, it's better to just concentrate on the overall picture, and Germany gets left behind there. Surely not the best healthcare system in the world if you deem the rate of nosocomial infections important. Now, if the situation worsens, we can just move on to three resistances to keep the numbers down. If it's just like with the Fukushima nuclear plant disaster, where the Japanese government simply increased the radiation limits for all kinds of stuff, life can be really easy. Well, just for politicians, though. Now, the difference between the West and Japan is that some of those politicians and company officials at least drank some of the radioactive water in front of TV cameras to produce the proof that they are right. There were public apologies and even a couple of resignations. Just pawn sacrifices, but better than nothing, I guess. But hey, let's just assume the German government is white and that we made a lot of progress in the last decade. Here we are looking at a table that is shedding some light on the rate of progress that has been made once more strict guidelines and regulations got implemented to combat the resistant bacteria threat. At least according to the statistics that, of course, can be interpreted in several different ways. The UK must have the best statistic manipulators of all participants, or otherwise they must have put in a really big amount of effort and also money to get the situation in the country under control. It looks like it has been a huge success, surpassing Germany with such a bad starting position of more than 40%. Now, I talked about the time when Germany finally woke up to the threat a little while back. One thing is for sure, we were pretty late to the party. I won't back this up with another paper, but I can tell you right here that while it looks like the Netherlands were the first ones to adapt a comprehensive bundle of regulations and laws, the UK acted even earlier. The issue was that the hospitals there couldn't provide the room needed to put these laws into action with isolation procedures and whatnot. On top, some people didn't like the costs associated with this way of handling things. Where are the profits with this? So in the end, the UK abolished most of its groundbreaking provisions and in turn became one of the most dangerous spots for nosocomial infections in Western Europe for quite some time. But by the looks of things, they learned their lessons and are back on track. Well, too bad a lot of people had to die because of this U-turn back in the 80s. Lawsuits incoming? Well, I guess not. Let's refrain from such revolutionary thoughts. Let's try and look at some of the differences that are present even today when comparing the situation in Germany and the Netherlands. The Netherlands adopted a so-called search and destroy policy. Now I will try to simplify things a bit here. They actually do search actively for resistant bacteria on each and every person that gets admitted to a hospital. Now I don't think the tests are done for every single patient, but they do have questionnaires and risk patients get tested in any case. Some risks include persisting wounds, working with livestock, or having spent more than 48 hours in a hospital abroad within the last couple of months. Everywhere I went to, I got these questionnaires and they tested me on every occasion, since I came directly out of a German hospital, where I just managed to stay a couple more than 48 hours. In German hospitals, those tests aren't mandatory. It's up to the hospitals in question on how they handle things. With the one I went to for my surgery, the one that's creating a whole bunch of problems for me right now, they did mandatory tests on admission and also on the supposed start of the radiation treatment. The hospital where my mother received brain surgery in 2013 didn't do any tests, and the one where she went to just a week ago to get the tumor removed didn't care about it either. The latter ones had no warning signs on any doors and no protective gear and special cabinets parked in front of half the doors of each and every ward. And that's in contrast to the hospital where I spent 2 weeks before and after my cancer surgery, where more than half of the doors on the ward were equipped with warning signs and had these cabinets with all the gloves, goggles, capes and whatnot at the ready. So when there are no warning signs and no protective gear, these other hospitals have absolutely no issues with bacteria, right? Well, actually, that's not the case. They just don't know if their patients harbor dangerous stuff because they don't do any tests. With the facilities that do tests, you get half the ward cordoned off. Not very trust-inspiring, all in all. And it does make me wonder why official figures are so low, when my own experience suggests a number closer to at least 30-50%, not just 10. And I haven't been put on some special isolation ward, it was just a regular surgical one. The same applies to the rehabilitation facility where I was together with my mom back in 2013. They did tests for each patient, and in consequence, numerous doors had signs and equipment posted, coming close to 50% at times. Well, that is the search aspect. Let's look at the destroy part. In the Netherlands, once they found resistant bacteria with you, there will be isolation, a limited staff contact, and instead of just treating your primary disease, they will also put a lot of effort into getting rid of the infection for good. Usually you will stay at the hospital until the infection is cleared. In Germany, on the other hand, they treat your primary disease, and once this is more or less under control, they send you back home, leaving the treatment of these resistant bacteria to your general practitioner, and also yourself. On some surfaces, resistant stuff can survive up to 1 year without any additional help. Now try to get rid of the stuff in your everyday environment where you can regain the infection by unknowingly touching the wrong item. So-called decolonization is successful in just about 90% of all cases, resulting in 10% persisting infections and or colonizations. And of those that manage to get decolonized, 40% contract MRSA again within just one single year. Well, sorry for the German text word here, but I'm trying to use local data whenever possible. Overall, in Germany, such an infection doesn't even get handled like a real disease, just some annoying nuisance. Now, by the way, try to be honest while harboring stuff like this. It will be more or less impossible to get appointments with the dentists, rehabilitation facilities, etc. It's like being an outcast with leprosy. At first they don't take it seriously, calling you crazy, and after the shit hits the fan, they don't want to have anything to do with you anymore. And that's fucked up, to be honest. I'm simply not that eager to become one of those fellows forced to lie and risk other people's health and even lives while just trying to survive. I promised to come back to Japan on this topic, and data isn't that easy to come by as the majority of it gets apparently published in Japanese only. Over there, no European Union or some other standardizing body exists, so it's up to the World Health Organization, which probably is more focused on, pretty lethal stuff like Ebola. Anyway, in Japan, we are talking about 30 to 40% allegedly instead of Germany's 20-something. As with the UK, Japan has no big history of livestock herding, so I expect them to be able to pull similar numbers in the foreseeable future. There's a similarity between antibiotic use for livestock purposes and MRSA prevalence. Countries with lower livestock and or lower antibiotic usage within this business have an easier time to reduce prevalence once they finally got their head around to it. Since I wasn't planning on getting any additional surgeries in Japan, my personal life won't get influenced that much anymore by these buggers. And the thing that I want to prevent is bringing German MRSA strains to Japan that are more difficult to detect, since over there they are predominantly dealing with Japanese or Asian variants of these bacteria, and not European ones. I want to get over there clean. Unknowingly, spreading local variants is part of the risk of living in Japan. For me and the local population as well. I'm going to kick the wind pretty soon, and I want to have a clear conscience to be ready for a potential judgment once I've left this world. I never had a negative impact on anyone or anything, and I wanted to stay like this. Aside from this, in Japan and also the United States, you got a lot of bad hospitals and doctors, but also a couple of institutions that can be described as world-leading ones, that are constantly doing pioneering work. If anything, I would get myself admitted at one of those institutions. The hospital where I want to get my radiation treatment in Tokyo is one of those where I might even get the chance to participate in clinical trials for some new approaches to my cancer, like I talked before earlier in this video. In Germany, you won't be able to find leading hospitals like this, so everything is more or less average at best. But to finally conclude this topic, if the German doctors and the authorities, the healthcare system as a whole, could actually get around to do the fucking job the way they are supposed to, I could stop with my fucking obsessions. It's outrageous to be accused of being crazy with the amount of bullcrap that's happening every day regarding German healthcare, a bullcrap of which my mother and me are getting reminded of every time we come in contact with that very system. We got so much money and knowledge here in Germany, it could be way better and not just average. Healthcare isn't meant to generate profits. If you try it anyway, you will get a mess like the one we have on our hands right now. Dutch healthcare officials estimate that in my federal state alone, at least 150 lives could be saved each year if a similar search and destroy policy would get enacted. I really do wish that the ones in charge and responsible for it not becoming reality will meet some of those peoples and their families in the afterlife. These are actual people, not just some random numbers on statistic pages and cost sheets. And that I, as an autist, feel compelled to point this out. I just don't know anymore who's sick in the head and who isn't. Now, sorry for the harsh break right now, but we need to get back to the radiation treatment. Thankfully, there are only 2 more pages left, and we already tackled most of this content earlier. These are the summarizing sheets where my signature would be required at the end. First up is my actual disease, and that's soft tissue sarcoma. No details or outcome prognosis are provided. The therapy goals are to establish local control by preventing local recurrence, and this in turn should improve my overall outcome. The major therapy risks are compiled once again in one single spot. Immediate and permanent damage to radiated tissue, be it skin, subcutaneous tissue, bones, blood vessels, nerves, or even lung tissue, everything goes. Scarring, inflammation, necrosis, functional impairment, complete joint stiffening, bone fractures, as well as paralysis and swelling. These are just the major risks, and the estimated likeliness for those to happen for the regular patient is at up to 5%, as stated here on this sheet. For my personal case, a figure of 20% is given. Now, I don't think this is an exaggeration, probably quite the contrary. Last page notes that the recommendation for therapy is mostly based on national guidelines, and yes, that's correct. You won't find any guideline here in Germany that won't recommend adjuvant radiotherapy with a tumor like mine, and that also applies to international guidelines as well. Now, next, I try to provide some kind of outlook, even if it looks kind of bleak. This is the consequences of various things. And the first one is the consequence of actually doing nothing, just waiting. And this is noted with the relapse. The consequence of just undergoing chemotherapy is, again, as well, a relapse. Surgical options available, well, apparently there are some left, but they mostly consist of cutting my right arm and shoulder off, so I'm not interested in those. Planned therapy duration is 6 weeks, Monday to Friday. It's not noted anywhere, but I guess we are looking at the overall radiation dose of like 60 to 70 gray. Precautions are listed with no bathing or swimming and no manual lymphatic system drainages. The last paragraph, possible consequences of the therapy regarding my ability to work, impact on my lifestyle, and also most importantly on my income. And that says that severe and permanent damage is possible. Well, I guess that's it, folks. Would you put your signature here? I'm utmost reluctant to do so. I think that in Japan, the doctors will put a lot more thought into this, as I will become stuck down there if the side effects should turn out to be severe. The Ministry of Justice, which is also responsible for immigration issues, will surely be interested in how this mess could have happened in the first place. With the stuff in Germany, is I don't care if I get stuck here forever, if I would require lifelong medical aftercare, if I won't be able to drive a car or carry a backpack anymore, because I'm in Germany, where we got the best healthcare system in the world and things, you know the deal. Then there's this new treatment option for synovial sarcomas that claims to have less side effects than conventional treatment. I don't want to exclude myself from it just because I already reached my personal radiation limit after completing a course of regular radiation therapy. I will give the medical staff at my hospital 2 more weeks to hand over my medical documents, and when there's still no cooperation by then, the case will get transferred to a lawyer. From there it will take ages, and I will be on my way without any therapy or documents. I need to stop wasting my precious time on crap like this. Sitting here doing more or less nothing, while risking my life for this nothingness as well. There should be more to it than just this. What other options do I actually have? I can't even ask for a second opinion or some clinical trial in Germany without any kind of documents, since I won't be giving in to the kind of pressure the hospital staff is exerting on me by this. I need to go all in. At least I've gone full circle again. This rather lengthy video was some kind of heads up to what has been going on the last couple of weeks. I will get back working on the next and probably also final planning video ASAP, as it won't make much sense to post planning videos directly from Japan. Hope you will tune in again for that one, and bye for now.